Okay, my name is Charles Bibbs, and I've been very privileged to be responsible for the exhibition called Black Artists on Tour. And this has been a dream of mine for many years. And now I think we're finally getting a handle on what this is all about and how we can represent and present the art of African Americans. And my whole dream was to put together a collection of art and have it travel across the country and travel in a way where we can stimulate interest on the part of the African American community, we can stimulate sales on part of the individual artists, and all this would be done by professional people. People who have knowledge about the art, who have knowledge about the industry, and they can represent artists. Instead of artists going out and representing themselves, we put them on a higher level by having representation. And we have representation in a professional way, in a way that all of our people can be proud of our presentation. And I think we have made very big strides. This is just one of many collections across the United States, and hopefully we can start this collection by representing not so much of the mainstream artists of old or our pioneers, but current contemporary artists that really, in a lot of cases, don't get the opportunity to be shown on this level. And you will find out in this exhibition, we do have probably, I would say, about 75% of the art here is from contemporary African-American artists who do their art specifically for a living. They are basically artists who are just happen to be entrepreneurs. So with that, we wanted to give a subject to this exhibition. So we came up with the subject of, is there an African-American aesthetics? This is a question that has been argued and debated for many years. And we're going to just give you a perspective on the level of the individual artist on what we feel without any prejudice from any other sources. And this is our gut feelings on what we think about that subject. And the people I have here today are Larry Poncho Brown, Deborah Shedrick, and Gwendolyn Redfern. And these are all accomplished artists in their own rights. They're very close friends of mine, and we're currently involved in what we call a artistic quarantine or creative quarantine, where we've isolated ourselves for 3 weeks and trying to put out as much work as possible. So, with that, I want to lead in and give our guests an opportunity to introduce themselves.
Hi, my name is Larry Poncho Brown. I'm from Baltimore, Maryland. I've been a professional artist for 27 years. It's an honor to participate in this event. Not often do we get museum representation. When it comes to our work, typically we'll see our work come out in February during Black History Month. So it's nice to see a museum take on the task of showing what I think should be shown nationwide. The industry has accepted African American art as a category for the last 20 years. The subject of whether it has an African-American aesthetic, pretty much to me, is a simple question. But the more you talk about it, there's a whole lot of opinions that come into play. Academia has one perception of that, and artists would naturally have a different view. I find it impossible for African-American art to not have an African-American aesthetic. Whether I'm painting a flower or a chicken or a person, I'd like to think that my exposure would have some impact on what the imagery looks like. Also, you can look at it from another perspective. I'm classified as a figurative artist. So my works generally have an African or African Afrocentric feel to them. whereas I know other colleagues of mine that may have different subject matter where it may not be as apparent, but I think that their spirit is still entwined with what they do. The industry itself has categorized our work as being colorful. You hear that a lot. We like the colors. Well, that's one thing we're known for. We're also known for figurative images. If you look at our history, even from Africa, most of the artwork there was figurative and symbolic. And you see a lot of that used in contemporary African-American art today, even including artists that are from the Caribbean. But my personal experience is that all of my work is a depiction of everything that I see around me. So it's kind of hard for that not to be a part of what I do.
My name is Deborah Shedrick. I've been an artist for approximately 20 years. When I started painting, I was 30. I didn't have a lot of support from my family or people around me because they really didn't understand art. They really didn't have African or African-American art hanging up in our home. I think we're here today in this museum because we've put ourselves here. We've made others notice what we do. If it wasn't for that, I don't think we would be here. The first trip I took to Africa, I noticed and understood that all black people are creative. Everyone in that country that I met had some creativity in them. And coming back home to America, we as a people don't realize how creative we are.
That's right.
And I try to tell everyone that I come into contact with, you have a lot of creativity in you. You just need to focus on what you want to do and what you think you have in you, because there is something in you. I know we're here also because of artists that have come before us. We have to recognize that they went through a lot to get where they got, for us to get to where we are, and we are making way for other artists that want to be professional artists. They won't have as hard a time as we have, and I think that's our responsibility for them not to have as hard a time as we have.
My name is Gwendolyn Redfern. I'm a native of Raleigh, North Carolina. I come from a family that my father was a painter. My sister graduated with a painting degree and teaching degree in art. And I followed suit with a painting degree and ceramic degree. I've always been an artist, as long back as I can remember. I always drew, always painted. Can't think of anything else. It came to me as if I was learning how to walk or, you know, taking my first breath. The only thing I can remember is just doing art. When I was in college, I think that was the first time anyone had mentioned to me, one of my teachers, where did you learn how to capture the colors? At that point, I was totally lost. I never really studied African-American art or African art or anything in our heritage. I just pretty much grew up pretty sheltered to myself, very limited friends, and all I did was play basketball, draw, and watch TV. But when I got to college, it was the first time anybody had said anything about where did I get the colors from. And I had no clue. It just came naturally. We didn't have a whole lot of art in our house hanging up. We didn't have pictures of colorful art or anything. You know, pretty much bare walls. My sister's an abstract artist. totally abstract. I'm an abstract artist too, yet I also do some realistic figures within my pieces. What I paint deals with what I see on an everyday basis. The figures are African-American figures because that's what I see just about every day. You tend to draw the people that you see all the time. Nowadays, so far as the colors, most of my colors tend to be in the red family. I still don't have a clue where that came from. As far as the ceramics that I do, that also tends to have an African-American feel to it. The designs that I put into my pottery are very geometric. And some of that also overflows into my paintings. When you really look at the paintings, you'll see a connection with the geometric shapes, architectural shapes, and the backgrounds. So in essence, I think without knowingly, seeing a lot of art, studying African-American art, sometimes I think it's you're born with it, and it comes out.
I remember when I was in college and also in high school that I had a difficult problem in my life drawing class because it was very difficult for me to draw the way my instructor wanted me to do in terms of getting the right anatomy, okay? He told me, he says, "What, Charles, why are you always simplifying everything?" Because I would stylize everything. And at that time, I couldn't understand why, because it just looked right to me, and it had a feeling about it. So I really had to train myself to learn how to draw the traditional way, okay, in order to get a grade, okay? But when I got out of college, I went back to that and reformulated that style that I always had this urge to do deep down inside my heart, okay? And I think that has a lot to do with genetics or wherever we come from. You know, Deborah, you mentioned that everybody in Africa seemed like they had a talent or had a craft or had some kind of artistic skill. I believe I was born with that whole idea because I can't even remember not even painting or drawing or creating. I do remember getting in a lot of trouble painting on the walls and stuff because we didn't have enough materials to express myself. It's been a part of my life and part of my being ever since. But I can say one thing is that the desire to break down forms in the simplest elements and coming up and stylizing is something that I have to attribute to Africa, because the African culture, if you really look at it, study it, is all about that simplification of the forms. Where you have Eastern cultures, I mean, European cultures, they're all about getting things down anatomically correct, where we were breaking things down in simple forms. Now, the question is that, is that an aesthetic? Is that something that you can attribute to one culture? Is that the way Black people do things?
I can't see how you can separate your DNA from who you are. The fact that you simplify things the way you do, you probably came from a family ancestry that did something like that. Because I do a lot of masks. I always tend to want to do a mask. And I sit down and say to myself, I must have come from a family of mask makers. And the masks that I do, I connect that to my ancestry and the experiences that I have here in this country, the experiences that my family and friends have in this country, I think formulates what I do as an artist.
My background comes from, I'm a second generation artist. My father was an artist. He chose to move into another career because there were no outlets for him as an artist. He went into printing industry and began to teach. Being a frustrated artist, I didn't get any support in the realm of being an artist, because that was the one thing I did for entertainment. When I went to art school in high school, it was a vocational training in high school. I was all black school. I caught into things rather quickly. I was the first student they ever put on work study in the 10th grade. So here I was, 14 years old, with my first artistic job. And then from that experience, went to college, which was all white school. And immediately I learned that there were some differences. There were certain things they were curious about my work that I never questioned. Color was always an issue. Composition was always an issue. Simplicity of form was always an issue. And at times, because I was quite rebellious, I often wondered why they were attacking me for my artistic sensibilities. It took me a while to understand that within any institutional setting, they want you to start with the basics, but then I was already at the basics. But it took me a while to understand that I had to learn all those forms before I got back. It's funny, Charles said he eventually evolved back to what he was doing before his college years, where I'm doing exactly the same thing. The same stuff I got hollered at in college, I'm basically doing for a career now. I can do realistic forms, but I choose to do more stylized forms. And that just comes natural. I think that most artists do what comes natural. We are all sponges who, we absorb a lot of different imagery, but somewhere along the line, our fingerprint gets cast on whatever we see. It is easy for me to walk up to a piece and tell if a person is black, and that's an arguable point. Can you walk up to a piece without seeing the artist's name and title and determine whether that person is African American?
Good question.
I think that out of 80% of the pieces that I see on the African American market, which are selected by other folks that may see those same things, they may say yes, you can tell by looking at it. But then I have colleagues that you would never know by walking up to them. So, but I think that it's all open to the viewer. The content is there. And like other folks mentioned in this conversation, it's hard for us to separate our DNA, where we come from the works that we do. And I think that if more people took time to learn where the artists come from and get into their process versus trying to just criticize the end result, we probably would have a different response to the African-American art and in the African-American art realm.
To walk up to a piece of artwork, whether they're African-American, Hispanic, 90% of the time, or as Poncho said, 80% of the time, I would say, yes, you can tell. There's a fine line with the other 10% that cross borders. If they're not realistic artists or deal a lot with figurative work, then you have to look at the color, the pattern design. And if they have very subdued colors and not much, then it is very hard to tell whether African American or anything. You don't know. Right. But when I look at art today from all cultures, a lot of it is, quite a bit of it is figurative. So it's easy for you to tell at that point. But I look at some of Deborah's work and hers, which I told her just the other day, look just as good as some of our counterparts, whether or not African American, and it looks just the same. And I would not know, we're looking at some of her pieces, that this person was African American.
So that would be the American part of, I guess, my culture. Because we all have so many different cultures in us that they come out, I think the different cultures come out periodically. Because I've had some Native Americans look at my work and say, you must be from this tribe because your work looks so much like those people. Mm-hmm.
let's give an example. Let's take Jacob Lawrence. Jacob Lawrence chronicles in art the struggles of blacks at a period of time during the Harlem Renaissance. Now, most artists, traditional artists, could have took other methods to illustrate what was going on.
I think that
in almost a pictorial sense. But he chose to break it down into a stylized interpretation of what was going on. The whole series of the Exodus that he portrayed, I think that is a perfect example of an African-American interpretation of art.
That is what was needed at that time, and he was the one chosen to do that. I think the work that we do is all spiritually based, and Jacob Lawrence was doing what he was supposed to do at that point.
He definitely was the man in his life.
I think that if you pan around the room at the pieces that are here, as a small example, you'll see some things that are unifying threads, no matter whether it's a Jacob Lawrence or Varnell Honeywood or Romare Bearden. You notice that most, and I don't like using the word African American too much because there's a word that I use called ethnic. Their works, I even categorize it as ethnic or non-ethnic to me. And that might be very stark, but that's how I filter through the work. But if you look at that one wall over there alone, you see a couple of different eras represented. And every one of them is using primary colors, simplistic forms in their own way. And that's a characteristic of African-American work. African work, the islands, look at the islands, it's the same thing. You know, black people come from an environment where we use earth colors and then we use pigmented colors to do really, really bright fabrics. And that stuff, if you look at the work over here on that one wall, for an example, you see the same thing depicted in all those pieces. And it might be a 20 or 30 year span between the pieces that's on the wall. So I think that we're used to dealing with certain things, but like Deborah Shedrick's work, for instance, she said that they would compete against our counterparts. But I could look at Deborah Shedrick's work and know immediately it's black, because most of our counterparts don't use black for skin. Okay, so it might be a small, minute thing, but when I look at the counterparts' work, they're also very conscious of what colors they use to depict skin color. Ethnic folks use what color they see. So you're going to see browns, yellows, browns, even stark black. You don't see stark black being used as skin tone in anything European for the most part. So for me, when I assess figurative images, that's one of the first things I noticed, because for the longest time I never saw anything that had a black patch or a brown patch. It's exciting for me to see a black or brown patch. I even had a discussion with Deborah the other day where I said, well, what would happen if you use another skin tone other than black? And I saw an immediate furrow of her brow, because that's something that she's naturally inclined to do. You know, so I've often had my work scrutinized for being too black. And I don't know how you explain it to me.
Well, you are too black.
I'm too black. I can watch my work in an exhibit, and I can watch white people come by my booth, and they're terrified of me. They're stunned, they spend 2 seconds, and they leave. Whereas I can watch a Latino come by, somebody from the islands come by, and they're not intimidated by it. You know? So the aesthetic is there. How far you scrutinize it is another question.
I like to call what black people do, African Americans do, is soul. And I think if you correlate the music, what we call somebody got soul, okay, it relates back to the black experience and the way that interpretation in song is rendered. And I think African American art, when you're talking about an African American aesthetics, we can call it soul. You know, you got soul in the art because it follows the same patterns and looks of a whole culture, okay? And it relates and it communicates. It communicates only to those people that can understand the experience. the experience of being black in America. When you see an artist who portrays a saxophone player or somebody singing the blues or an event in the history of black people and how they portray it, it immediately registers with the viewer because they're connected, okay? We're not that impressed with photographic rendering, okay? As a people, we're not. We're impressed with bold colors. We create terms that are outside of the normal language. You call jewelry bling bling. That's soul. I mean, that's an expression in art. We take in everyday scenes in life and interpret it in an African American sense. So now we're really talking about the aesthetics. Okay, black people have been changing America ever since slavery.
It's not African, it's not American, it's African American.
Yeah, right. There's a big difference between the two. One of the things I've always been concerned about is our work is a depiction of who we are. It's always interesting to see how people scrutinize what we do. The colors that we use are not accidental. When the art industry decided to embrace African-American art and make a category to be marketed, they approached it as if it was faddish, like it was going to be something that came in and went out. They never really could pinpoint what that thing was that made people levitate to the art. So naturally, they hired other artists to depict what they thought, but pieces just didn't have the energy. One thing that people don't talk about with African American art is spirituality. It's interwoven in the pieces. Mm-hmm. It's one of the few places where African Americans can go nowadays and get total 100% representations, positive representations of who we are. We don't get it in the news. We don't get it always through our music. We don't get it in the movies. So, you know, it's one of the few places where you can go and get positive representations. There was maybe 20 years ago, everybody was doing Southern scenes, slavery scenes, struggle scenes, and now here it is 20 years later, and it covers just about every gamut of every subject that we deal with. Family is at the core of most of the pieces we're talking about. You know, women are still 80% of the images. Men are now becoming more part of the images. So you, when you look at the work, you see trends. We're still documenting what's important at this time in our communities, whether it be the way I render a flower or the way she renders a flower, is the same thing. That energy is interwoven in the music.
I pretty much agree with everything that's been said. I come from a different viewpoint where, once again, and with any culture, any culture, but most of the cultures, once again, most of it's realistic. You're dealing with images, people. And so therefore, yeah, you're going to know that it's an African-American person because with the features of the face, the features of the body, and also and the colors you use. Once again, go abstract. There are a few abstract artists that you can say yes. I look at, correct me if I'm wrong, Norman Lewis?
Yes.
I look at his work, some of his work, you know, the dude was a black man.
Hmm.
He's an abstract artist.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm saying. Once again, listening to the conversation on the table,
mm-hmm.
most of what you say deals with realistic work.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, yes, 9 times out of 10, you're going to be able to tell what culture they come from.
Let's talk about Caucasian artists that do images of black people. Now, I can look at their work, let me say 90% of the time, and tell they're not black artists.
I can tell right away.
There is something about that art that I am just not feeling.
It's spiritless and it's colored brown. And I can always tell.
Yeah.
the biggest issue we have right now is academically. Okay, if we look at museums right now, the African American pieces that they normally select are pieces that are interpreted as no color. They don't pick heavily figurative images. They tend to lean towards abstraction and pieces that don't have a black consciousness to it. Most of us as artists, when we apply to our shows today, don't do well in jurying with the subject matter that's on our slides. You know, so that's a big issue. We start talking about where's the aesthetic? Well, if the aesthetic is not being supported even in our museums, then what are we basing it on? We have a long way to go, and that's why I think this exhibition is so important, because here you are, you got a group of contemporary works, and it's amazing how you can look around this room and see how each one is linked together.
Yes.
And there's a multitude of artists from a multitude of walks of life.
Yes.
I do agree with Gwen Redfern in the fact that we're all getting tired of being separated if it's not figurative or abstract. And what is the big deal whether the person is black or not? I don't have a problem with that. I like to be able to identify the two, but I also would hope we would get to a point one day where artists are recognized for being artists, period, and not so concerned about whether they're black and whether they're painting black.
Because we can do figurative work, and we can also do abstract work.
But let's not leave out the fact that art down through the millenniums has been broken down in classifications based on what was going on at that time. Now, we have a short history in America, okay? And believe it or not, black people, when they first got off the slave ships, were trained to paint in the traditional fashions for the master, okay? I can just imagine a slave who just came from Africa being forced to paint in a traditional English or Dutch fashion, but that was the case. I can see situations where he's in the big house painting, but at night he's creating his African culture. And sometimes in a lot of these paintings, when you look at these paintings, you can see the struggle between conforming to something that he's forced to do and something that it's in his soul to do. It took hundreds of years until blacks got the freedom to think on his own and demonstrate his own culture. But even in the early architectures, back in the formation of this country, they've got architecture that was patterned after Africa, that was accepted. And I think some of the slave houses had an African architecture. So this whole shotgun house effect was rooted from Africa. So down through history, it's not so much the subject matter that we get involved in, it's how we interpret it, that is the aesthetics. It doesn't matter whether we're painting a building, whether we're painting a flower, whether we're painting some white people on the street. If a black person does it, he does it in a certain aesthetic fashion. That's the whole subject of this exhibition. That's what we're trying to analyze and determine. Okay, so I can look at Redfern's work. I can see Africa coming out of every brushstroke. I can look at Deborah's work, it's just obvious. And forget Poncho. Poncho he can't help himself. He can't help it. I mean, it's just part of his soul. It just comes out. There's no way you can change that. I don't care how you try to, you would have to go into some concentration camp and be subjected to some severe brainwashing to get that out of you. So now, if it's in there that deep, it's gotta be aesthetically rooted in the culture. It's gotta be aesthetically rooted in the people. And that's my position. That's what we're trying to demonstrate in this exhibition today. I select all these pieces based on what I felt was the best ideal and example of that. And I think in every one of these pieces, you can see it just oozing out of the lines, out of the paint, okay, that African-American aesthetic.
And one other important point that I think we didn't raise is that this room is comprised of what we consider to be educated and self-taught artists. Because when you start talking about those two subjects alone, you even see another division. Artists that have been educated have all had their experiences with trying to conform or not conform, whereas self-taught artists have always done what was innately natural for them to do. And so if you start with self-taught, I move them first to educated, it's still the same thing. All of us have been doing this. If you read every artist's bio, by the age of four, I started. It's not magical that we're 4 years old when we first start gaining the sensibilities of recognizing or even realizing that we have that innate ability. That's a developmental period at four to develop that thing. So it's innately there. It comes from somewhere. The Creator gave us this ability. He thought we needed a place to think, to resolve, to find solutions, to fantasize, and it's free therapy. He knew we would need that extra voice. And for me, that's the unifying thread with all artists, period. Now, once we start talking about people interpreting that, that's a whole different ballgame. So by the time you get academia that's going to discuss this subject, now you're talking about us, the artists, that are physically doing the work talking about the subject. And now there's a whole pool of other people that will always have their own definition or assessment of what this aesthetic is. But it's there, or it would be nothing to talk about.
One thing when I was in college, there wasn't that many African Americans in the art department, not even the painting department at all. Ceramics was very, very, there was only two. But my painting teacher told me, he says, you're very good by duplicating an image. You can take a photograph and match it to the T on a sheet of paper. Says, but I want to know what you have inside of you.
There you go.
And I think that's where the difference lies.
Mm-hmm.
Even in ceramics, I've had graduate students, mind you, this was my second semester in ceramics. Just baby learning how to form a pot. I've had graduate students come up to me and say, where do you get your ideas?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they would go and come back and say, look what I did. Why are you a graduate student? He copied my pot. I don't mind that you took the form that I did and you duplicated it. But what I think we have inside of us is we take what's there and bring something new to the table.
There you go.
And I think that's where we separate.
Mm-hmm. And you know what? And that's what we've been doing as a people for a long time. We've taken things that we've learned from the European point of view, and we tweaked it. We tweaked it in a way where we can understand and relate to it. It's just like music. There was that scene in Roots when Fiddler was playing the fiddle for the white folks. But Fiddler was putting his own African twist to that fiddle, okay, which was the roots to a lot of things that came later in terms of music, okay. So we've twisted a lot of things in American culture, okay. We put that African-American aesthetic or that African aesthetic to a lot of things in this culture and actually changed the face of this country in a lot of ways. We invented jazz. Now that's a African-American aesthetic in music, okay? And it's been embraced by the whole country. Now everybody's getting into jazz, okay? Now I'm just waiting for the day that African-American artists get recognized in the same way, because we put our people's flavor to art. We twerked it and twisted it and tweaked it, just like the jazz musicians did, just like
the hip-hop artists.
Just like the hip-hop artists are doing, okay? It's the same process.
And I think it's an embodiment of all our struggles, all our fears, all our pain. When I do an abstract piece, every innermost emotion that I'm feeling then is in that piece of artwork.
Yes, yes.
And when someone can come up and interpret that, mm-hmm. that's when the journey begins.
Yes, people really get involved in it because you're touching them, mm-hmm. okay? And I get to the point where I don't even want to give titles. I like to see people react to the art and get their own feeling from the art and get their own interpretations, because that's important, because that's what art is for, is to stimulate a response from the viewer. Okay, whether that response is negative or positive, if you get the response, the piece of art has been successful. That's all it's all about. And hopefully, I feel through the arts, through what we do, other people can get a better understanding of who we are. And I think that, once again, is what art is all about. And I think through art, different cultures can understand each other, and we can eliminate a lot of this intercultural strife that goes on in our communities. Art can heal a lot of wounds in the community if we give it an opportunity, if we give it a chance.
We're at a real important timeline in our history as artists in America. Not since the Harlem Renaissance has there been a revolution in art. And we're participating in one right now that many people have not coined a phrase for. In the last 20 years, the whole art industry has been turned on its side because of the admission of African-American art as a classification. And many people have rushed to the center to get a piece of that dollar. Many of us got opportunities that we never got before. And some of the art that was scrutinized just 20 years prior is now being marketed across the country by different dealers. So we don't know what that new revolution is going to be called. We've heard the popular artists. We've talked about a whole bunch of things, but basically we're really changing the face of art. Not since the Cosby Show and before that with Good Times, when Ernie Barnes' work showed up on TV, that we have accessibility to this work. And that's the biggest thing that's changing everything now, is massive accessibility. It changes everything when the people you design the work for get to see and embrace the work. Because prior to that, it was for the folks that could afford it. Nobody ever had a chance to embrace it. Most of the artists that were in the Harlem Renaissance, their work was not accessible to the globe. You know, and this is a global period we're living in now. So hopefully this is the first African-American exhibit at this museum. And hopefully as it travels, it will become the first African-American exhibit at some other museums. But the bottom line is that museums have to start taking a chance at just showing what we do. Assessing it, well, leave that for the historian.
That's a great ending to this discussion. Unless anybody else has any more comments, I think we've done quite well. Thank you very much. You all should be applauded.